said good day, sir!
Hello and welcome back to The Defense here live from our joinDOTA studio in Berlin. We are about to head into the third game of this very series as Alliance is going up against Team Liquid. Alliance won the first game, Team Liquid tied it up in the second game, and let's actually take a quick look at the brackets so we see where we're standing. OG already played Team Alternate, a 2-0 was the result of that game, and OG is now waiting in the upper bracket, and we're gonna find out if Team Liquid or Team Alliance will be joining them. The other teams will be going down to the lower bracket, which we will be following tomorrow before we heading into the grand finals. All the games up until the grand finals are played in a best of three, and the grand final is gonna be a best of five. Now, let's talk about the game coming up. What do you guys think we're going to see from either of those teams?
I anticipate a very fanatic Alliance fan hanging that button. Alliance is back. Not back, back, not back, hey, back,
I
not
I
back, not
I
back.
I told you, man, like the finger, you have it on the one. All of a sudden, just slants to the right for number two.
Alliance is back, press one.
You put bag of shame right here, and then you just put it on after that second game.
I don't even know if you actually want to shame yourself at that point. It's like, you know what? It happens, boys. Like, it just happens. It's Alliance things.
Just Alliance things. Yeah. But we are playing in a double elimination, so, you know.
True. There's always another chance.
There's always another chance.
I mean, they haven't even lost the game yet, guys. They still have one more game.
Okay, that was meant for both of those.
let's break down the series as a whole, though. The thing is that game one was a messy game that was back and forth, and it could have actually gone either way if either team cleaned up their act faster, right? Game two was very different. Game two was a draft win for Liquid, which it could have been in game one as well. It was also them controlling the game. Like, they didn't make very many mistakes. They didn't give any openings for Alliance. This is the Liquid that they can be. Now Alliance have to prove that, you know, the kind of team that they can be in this game three. Otherwise, they're just going to get taken out by a looking better Liquid.
I couldn't think of a descriptor for that.
And this is Liquid, who were notoriously bad in second games in series. They would always kind of, you know, win first, lose second, and then close the series, which they were always very good at, is ending a best of three with a win, which honestly I'm expecting here against Alliance. Game number two, like you said, draft victory for Liquid. I think they can continue that.
That's right. They have a thing about losing game one, huh? I forgot about that.
Usually they win game one, lose game two. Like, they almost always lost game two. And then game three is just like, well, we fooled you. We're actually playing now.
Well, game three will happen in just a little bit as the draft's already started. And you guys already said, like, you really don't want to see a PL going through and stuff like that, which we have been seeing in just that last game. Now, of course, Doom and Wisp being banned. Also, Darkseer, just like before. This time, also a Tusk ban.
You're playing against Alliance. You do not ban Nature's Prophet.
there's rules about this kind of thing. But at the same time, Liquid don't care about no rules.
They get a gyrocopter on their team. They take away one of, like we talked about it, Lota's been playing this more sacrificial carry role where he has to play a lot more aggressive in order to buy space for Amber Bulldog oftentimes. And we saw that in game two. Didn't really work out, even though he played quite well. The problem is that gyrocopter is by far the best carry to perform that kind of role. The other heroes that Alliance have gone back to, I mean, let's not even talk about Abaddon. Slardar is a potential pickup that they've done before in the one position that's kind of sacrificial, but it's very clear gyrocopter is the best hero for that. So Liquid getting it, I think, is a little bit of concern for Alliance.
The shoe's just on a different foot this time around. We saw the last games where Wyvern and Gyro were on Alliance, and now all of a sudden it's going to be on Team Liquid's side for the final game here. So it's just basically trading sides. Both of these heroes are always going to be strong in this patch and Undying here. I think, just going back to a little bit to last game, what would have happened if, you know, S4 had picked up that Quap instead of, you know, fourth, instead of leaving it to get banned out? Maybe it could have looked a bit better. So it seems like last game, or the first game, they left Slardar in for Admiral Bulldog. He shined on it. Last game, they picked up the Slardar instead of getting, you know, this Queen of Pain that could have actually helped out in the mid lane. And so it just seems like these final picks are kind of deciding the flow of the game and how they're going to be going.
Look at what Kuroki has selected. Please.
He's please tossing it up, though.
I need a magnifying glass. You can't see that far.
It's nature's profit. He has selected. Oh, they've switched it up.
See, I don't see a reason to ban it out. Like, you still got Wyvern, you still got Jarrah. You got an easy wave clear, so momentum for Bulldog isn't going to be there.
If you have taken away the Razor, I think Queen of Pain is by far your best mid for Fada, because he is so good at winning those 1v1 matchups, and that's why he's such a successful Razor, is partly because his laning phase dominance. I think Queen of Pain is the best hero that's left in that regard. You're picking it into an Undying, which isn't bad, because no disables there. You are picking it into a Bane, though, and that's slightly more concerning, especially since Bane is very adept at dual lanes.
They ain't having none of that, Cap. Okay. They ain't having none of that.
I really think Queen of Pain should have been their pickup, but I guess they have a lot other Fada heroes. We were talking about that before, where Fada's hero pool is perhaps a little bit bigger than Matu's.
I'm confused as to why they banned it out too, because they're still Shadow Fiend in the pool. Normally you want to go for the Queen of Pain against the Shadow Fiend. Do they have some kind of contingency plan? Are they going to go for like an Invoker against it? What are they trying to really bait out here? Because Alliance, we saw first game, S4 handling the Shadow Fiend, he played extremely well. Remaining. Is that going to happen again? We also have the Huskar plus the Dazzle guys. How's that? Okay, so Alliance, it's kind of like, okay, we're going to bait Alliance into picking that, it feels like. I don't know.
Yeah, well, we're starter picked up, I think. That removes Huskar out of the pool, I guess.
Are you fine if you're Alliance just picking up SF? Like, and the fact that Liquid bypassed that to pick up the Slaughter. Like, Bulldog's been having a pretty damn good time over on that Slaughter the last two games. Juggernaut. Even if they did lose the second one.
Juggernaut's really good versus Gyrocopter. It's a good fighting hero. Like, the Nature's Prophet that we were talking about before, and whether or not Liquid would ban that one away, it's like, Nature's Prophet doesn't really work with the Undying, right? Because they're polar opposites in many ways. Undying likes to fight early. Virion likes to farm. So I think Juggernaut works a lot better synergistically with this Alliance lineup so far.
I think Bane plus Juggernaut too, allowing easy setups on the Slaughter in the offlane. It's kind of like what we saw last game. Remaining. Glimpse back, Admiral Bulldog dies. We could see the same here. For Team Liquid, he has to be very careful, mind control, and where he goes with the Slardar now, because I think it'll be easy pickoffs. I really do love the Juggernaut pickup. Sure, you can counter it with the Winter Wyvern, but I think as long as they can, you know, manage to make sure that the Cold Embrace doesn't go on somebody, they can have great sustain with the Healing Ward, with the Undying, and they just have really tanky heroes right now for Alliance. I kind of like that for them so far, but Team Liquid's AoE right now, it's pretty crazy.
Especially if they combine it with the AA. It's
what are the best heroes versus Beastmaster mid? Razor's been taken out of the pool.
Shadow
Viper
Fiend's
they could ban away as four.
Shadow Fiend's pretty good against Beastmaster.
I mean, Beastmaster can still win that matchup or do all right.
He wins it once he gets six and he gets help.
Yeah.
Else he's just going to get raised to the ground, and it depends on what side the Shadow Fiend's on. Because if he's on the Radiant side here, he's just going to get exponential farm in the jungle. And then you're also going to have the Bane potentially rotating in.
So what about if you save your mid as Liquid and you pick up like a roaming hero? Like a Spirit Breaker wouldn't be bad necessarily against Juggernaut. It exploits the lack of disable on both him and on Dying. Remaining.
Biggest heroes that are kind of like flashing out still are Alchemist. Oh, well, we haven't. Alchemist. This is so much negative armor now coming in, and we've seen the new build on Alchemist. It's been working out tremendously, just rushing that Solar Crest. And yeah, now that you have to figure out what can you put against Alchemist that can punish that. Sure, Shadow Fiend can punish it a little bit, but you're still going to farm so much more on the Alchemist than
the
Shadow
Fiend.
Is this
when you can get away with getting something more like a Magnus, using the Empower buff up to just make it so the Juggernaut is just even stronger? Not a bad matchup as well.
Could work. Like we saw.
Yeah, I prefer offlane bag personally. Remaining.
It's not too bad here.
So then you can leave your mid reserve still open for a pick. That is the upside about the way Alliance is drafted here. Like, because they picked the Bane and the Undying in the early stages. This is assuming Undying is support, of course.
If you're Alliance now, though, you see the enemy hit mid hero. You don't want your mid hero to get banned out. This is where you probably want to pick it up. There shouldn't be any reason to really save it for last, though. Just okay, well, it could be nice call, Toby. And it could still be mid, or it could still be in the offlane. But I do rather have it in the offlane.
The thing about Magnus' fourth pickup as opposed to their mid, though, is it still keeps their lineup open because, as you said, it could be a mid Magnus, and they could still pick up an offlaner. Just depending on what's left. For example, if they still want the Shadow Fiend that's left in the pool, they can still get it and run an offlane mag and get kind of greedy with their draft.
How do you nuke down this Alchemist, though?
I mean, have we seen Bulldog play Magnus, though? That's the bigger question here. That's why we see the Phoenix ban.
It was always S4's hero.
Yeah.
It's always been S4's hero.
I think we've seen it once before.
I'd also wonder, too, if Alliance even feel locked to the lanes. Like, you've got to bane it on dying. That's a lot of aggression early on. You're not even locked to just running, like, standard lanes. You can put that Magnus on the safe lane if you want to, run the Juggernaut aggressive. Like, they've got multiple options with their draft. Depending on who you're up against, of course, but you think about the control of Team Liquid. What have you really got? You got Gyro's Rocket Barrage early on, you got a little bit of Arctic Burn from the Wyvern, the last support stagger in Ancient Apparition, so the damage is there, but the stuns don't really arrive until Slaughter and Alchemist really come online, or Wyvern gets level 6.
If that Magnus is offlane, I feel they need something like a Lina just to deal with that Alchemist and get that instant burst down.
That'll be nice for a mid.
You could definitely pressure him a lot in the mid lane.
Then you've got Bane Nightmare to set up for roaming around early on if you want to.
If you run Magnus mid, do you put a support with it? Do you, like, run Bane Magnus?
Kind of have to,
then
right?
You leave, like, the... Or Undying Magnus, maybe, and you spam out Decay. Because then that leaves the Slaughter available to get more farm at the bottom lane.
But that's when you can run the other heroes, like, as Doug said. Like, you run, like, a Lina. And a quick rotation in from the Bane, like, Slaughter might get something early on, but with a simple Nightmare, you've got the Initiation, and they go for the Brood.
A Brood against an Alchemist, that's bold.
Yeah, that's a lot of money.
So Alc can farm zombies. He doesn't, like, there's no base gold from zombies, but you get the bonus gold from Grievous Greed. He can farm Spiderlings. My goodness, if that Alchemist gets himself into a good position, he could just
If Alliance don't control, it's probably going to be the bigger thing. Like, if Admiral Bulldog slips in his control of Spiderlings, that Alchemist is going to get so fat so quick.
Yeah, so I'm just looking at the Broodmother. It's like, Slardar, Alchemist, Gyrocopter, Winter Wyvern.
It doesn't make a lot of sense.
Those are all valuable heroes against
Brood. But they have been playing Brood a lot, and Brood has been banned out the last few games as well for them. So let's see if they can make it work or not. But you guys are, as it seems, very scared of that Alchemist.
I'm very skeptical. But if Bulldog can pull this off, then it's going to be huge for him. But as Cab said, Team Liquid have the counters in droves. And that Broodmother could end up just being, like, Alliance's worst enemy.
Well, let's see if that's going to happen or not, or if the Brood is going to go and surprise us maybe in that game with Admiral Bulldog playing it. But the game is ready. The guys are ready. Our casters are ready. So let's take it away.
From analysts to casters, let's do it, Rio.
Let's do it. From scrubs to something.
Like, the camera was on me at that awkward point.
It's okay, man.
All right, Soul Ring first for Admiral Bulldog. Alliance are going to be trying to set up on the top rune. Liquid may try and fight them, though. They've got some decent heroes for it. Alchemist isn't amazing, obviously, because he's going to go Bounty first, but Gyrocopter and Undying are some of the stronger heroes at level 1, especially if they could start spamming out the Decay nice and early.
Yeah, you always want to contest the Alc's Grievous Greed early on. It's just, you know, a cat and mouse game always for these runes when you're playing against them. So we'll see if they get the better of it, if Team Liquid can dodge or...
I think Alliance honestly should dodge. I know you don't want to give up the Alchemist, that Grievous Greed, but it's still a scary proposition going into this Liquid team. Looks like they are going to be able to get the top rune.
Nah, Bulldog, they actually, if he clicked on the enemy heroes, he would have realized that they have no sentries or anything. He could have went for the play, but...
I mean, that's well worth it. People have talked about the idea of giving up First Blood in exchange for Bounty Rune.
I think it's worth it.
Yeah, because of the experience, because you're able to get back in lane in time. Oftentimes it's worth it. Obviously, it's even more worth it if it's the Alchemist.
When I was going to reference Eternal Envy, just because he did it once, he blinked in with an anti-mage, and he died for it, but he denied the 500 gold to him, and I think it's well worth it because you're still going to be splitting that gold between 4 or 5 heroes.
Yeah.
So you're not getting as much, and...
So sure enough, Alliance are going to be running a dual lane here in the mid with Ake on the Bane trying to harass out Fauna. It's not terribly surprising, but this does leave us with a double melee matchup for Slardar, so this should be one of the more favorable offlanes we'll see Mind Control getting.
Well... The good thing for Bulldog is they really don't have the disable, but they have the slow. They have the slow from the Arctic Burn, and then they can easily chase him down, I feel, with the Rocket Barrage. So he still has to be very careful, even though there's not that many stuns. Oh, bottom lane. Lota taking so much damage from the tower. They dove so hard for that kill.
And mind control, at least for a few seconds, is back in control until Lota pops that healing self, comes back. Admiral Bulldog, meanwhile, constantly being zoned out. Chilling Touch and Arctic Burn getting a lot of damage on Admiral Bulldog. He finally goes back to Invis and outside of that counter ward, but not before the damage has been done. It's going to be a rather slow Soul Ring, even though he started off with a recipe and 325 gold working towards it. He's just operating off of Tickled after that.
Yeah, he kind of needs to put down a sentry when they're not around. Oh my goodness, the Chilling Touch right click for... Poor Admiral Bulldog. If he could actually get, you know, a salve come out to him, and then he can, you know, put down the sentry, eat these tank or these sentries, it could be very effective. But he doesn't know where they're at.
Look at this CS board. You know how absurd this is? Like, half of the people have zero. The other couple of heroes that have any CS are 1, 1, and 3 CS so far. Everyone's spending so much time trying to zone out a hero or try and get some sort of kill.
Kebab,
you took that bounty rune, but you're gonna be giving up first blood to Fada.
So
it does make up for it.
It would have been about the same.
He hadn't picked up a single CS. Or actually, take that back. He's picked up one CS, and then he managed to get that first blood.
Now he's most net worth on
the
board.
Yeah, all of a sudden.
You're back, though.
Oh,
nice.
The Bane Sleep. They already get him back. Now he does have the stun. Dead. Is he going to try and go for a deny? It looks like he was hoping for it. Unfortunately, too much damage in time, and he's going to have to TP back out the lane.
Oh, man, this is giving me flashbacks to, like, 2 years ago when I used to see this a lot. Oh, bottom lane? They still don't have enough. They really need to rotate the Bane down if they want to kill Mind Control.
But both teams are very set on shutting down the heroes that they started from the laning phase shutting down.
Oh, yeah.
The supports aren't moving at well. They weren't moving out of the top lane. Jarex is actually stacking a little bit. But they know the Alchemist can make the recovery, while Broodmother, it's essential to keep the Broodmother down for as long as possible, while the Bane's doing something similar in this middle lane.
Oh, he missed the skewer. You saw that. They had the sleep set up, so I'm surprised that Ake didn't go for it again. That could have been another kill potentially going on to the Alchemist here. And I think, though, the Brood can always catch back up. You only really need to get that level 5, and then once the supports start rotating around or anything happens, you're just going to get so much space. You're going to take the tower, and I'm curious to see what he goes for. Oh, mid lane. They're going to be rotating over.
S4 is dropped incredibly low. They're going to hit him with the Unstable Concoction, but don't choose to pursue with that Arctic Burn. They probably got to have gotten some more damage on him, but they made the call that it wasn't going to be enough. So our big winners in CS are going to be the Gyrocopter, the Magnus, as well as the Juggernaut. So right now, Alliance are doing a bit better than Liquid in just CS, but of course, talk about net worth, and it becomes an entirely different story with Alchemist getting just free boatloads of net worth via bounty runes. The first one, and now the third one goes to him.
This is just not fair. How can a hero have 3 CS?
Second in net worth and 3 CS.
No, that's not fair.
It seems like a totally viable way to play Dota.
He's just going to rotate into the support position. I mean, well, now that he's almost level 5, he's going to rotate into the jungle. Do they have any stacks for him? Are they building
it up?
Yeah,
they had this one medium stack that they were doing. They missed one of the stacks, though. It's supposed to be a triple stack, but fortunately missed out. Lota, still level 4, so can't really threaten mind control all that much.
Yeah, the biggest benefactors in this game are probably the offlaners, just because there's no stuns on either side. Mind control is, however, losing out to Bulldog, though. Bulldog's 5, and he's only a level 3, so the Undying has been doing really well.
They're doing a lot better job denying on Lota than the Gyrocopter has.
And then some of the CS is inflated just because of the Spiderlings, too, so I would say it's about kind of even. We'll see. Mid lane, though, they're giving so much space to Ake now, and what's happened with S4? He's rotated into the jungle. I'm curious to see, he's going to probably rush the Blink Dagger, holding on to it. Normally you would see if you go the semi-carry build, you go for treads normally, or if you want to be, more supportive and you get the arcane boots, but he's going to be rotating down here. They might be able to get this kill on mind control.
He backs out in time, hits the stun.
Oh, he's juking it.
S4 is still hoping to be able to get him, but another stun comes out and S4 is unable to hit the skewer.
You know what I would like to see right now from Alliance? Somebody smoking and invading the enemy jungle and just warding up. You know the one of the alchemists is doing something. Oh, they got to sleep for fodder. Are they going to contest this? Oh, they can skewer him up on the hill.
Oh, unstable concoction. The skewer's going to come out, but Jarek's actually woke him up in the perfect time, and they do manage to get away. Both the support and now the invis rune on alchemist lets them get away.
Yeah, skewering up the wyvern isn't all that benefactory. And
whoa! Kuro, he ends up going down to the top lane. We're talking about how powerful the Broodmother can be once she starts getting some movement in this lane. She's got that host of spiderlings and heroes like Ancient Apparition and Winter Wyvern. Not really a match for it.
Yeah, Jarek needs Wyvern's some level. Okay. Yeah, you need to get the levels though for the Splinter Blast and then you can help out a lot clearing out these pesky spiders.
Curl's going to be taken over the middle lane, though. Obviously, there's a bit more incentive to get the Ancient Apparition to level 6 because you're a pretty useless hero without Ice Blast. So they're going to put him in the mid lane, and Fada's going to obviously do full-time jungle.
Are they going to RP for this bottom lane yet?
Mind Control faking out the RP. Lota has the Omni Slash. He's going to throw it down. Unable to get the crush off in time. There's just too much damage. This is a problem. Slardar, he was fine going up against this double melee matchup for a while, but once the Juggernaut hits his level 6, it's almost a guaranteed kill.
Seems like S4 just wants to put as much pressure on the bottom lane. He keeps on rotating down, trying to stop the Slardar, just giving so much space to Ake to get level 6, and it comes at a price. Like you said, Kuroki's in the mid lane. They're both going to be top lane.
Oh, the ultimate gets laid out, but still. Broodmother managed to get Matumba Man before Matumba Man got Broodmother.
Say that 5 times fast.
Yeah. Well. 4-2 now. You still have the Alchemist farming away, though. He's now level 7. He was able to farm through a lot of that stack. It's an okay net worth lead over the rest of these teams.
So good for Admiral Bulldog right now. He's just climbing his way back up.
Lota is a denying machine. Good lord. I'm watching him. He's just like last hitting underneath the enemy tower, constantly getting these denies.
Just go play.
He's 30 denies right now.
He should just go play an RPG, man. He's in the wrong game.
Poor Mind Control. He should be like level 6 by now if it wasn't for all these denies.
Yep. Good zoning out from the stand-in kebab and nice denies coming in from Lota. And we're going to be looking at Bulldog rushing this Orchid. I think it's really good if you can get it off at the same time as the Alchemist doesn't get his Chemical Rage off. If he does get it off, then you're most likely not going to kill him. And even though he's going for the Orchid, he still might have a very hard time killing him just because he's going for the Solar Crest on Fada. So he's still going to be very tanky even when he doesn't have the ulti on.
Stopping the unstable concoction.
Oh, Jarax. Jarax. Oh, my goodness.
Gets into the trees. The spiders are still following, though. Jarek's going to die eventually here, and there's not much Fada can do about it. Throws out a nuke. That's all he can do. Fada is going to be matched up, it looks like, against the Broodmother from here on out. But Admiral Bulldog's just going to be careful not to give up. Matumba Man has been spotted by Kebop. They're going to be able to get the sleep back into the tower. They get off the ultimate, but the RP is laid down. Matumba Man will die underneath this one. And Liquid just seemed to be missing out on something. The Ice Blast hits Ake, and is he going to take out?
Yeah,
it's going to be close.
He's dead. He's dead.
Tick, tick, tick. He's going to go to 80 HP.
Oh, no.
Sleep.
Okay.
No.
Yeah, it was a nice try, but.
In the end, that Ice Blast still gets him. Liquid are kind of spreading their experience around, like, because of the fact that Gyrocopter came bottom, and then the Winter Wyvern, well, he got that kill on the Broodmother, or was able to get the full experience of it, so he jumped up to level 6 really quickly. Then you had the Ancient Apparition mid while Fada was farming jungle. They are doing things perhaps a little bit more efficiently in that regard, but Alliance are definitely making up for it. The large number of kills that they're getting, and they're going to get another one. Splinter Blast gets laid out. He gets a lot of these spiders out with dust, and maybe Fada can actually catch something here. Unfortunately, Admiral Bulldog has gotten away.
And Bulldog might even just... Oh, man. So good right now from Admiral Bulldog, playing like an absolute monster in these last two games.
Oh, but they're going to catch Admiral Bulldog with the ultimate, but that's not going to be good enough.
Stunned,
they need another counter where they actually have it inside the laning phase. They're going to be able to see Admiral Bulldog get that unstable concoction, and they will get that kill. Jarek's going to pick it up off the Splinter Blast. Some sweet, sweet revenge for our Winter Wyvern. Yep. Meanwhile, Sarda did go down in the bottom lane. Once again, looks like an Omni Slash kill. Kind of expected.
I forgot. Okay, so Lota's going
to... But he's still not level 6.
He's just getting shut down, and that's normally what you want from your Slardar. Normally you can smoke in, have a dust on hand, and then you can find out the brood. Amplify damage, and then you can get these easy pickoffs because you'll have sight of him all the time. So, but since he's been shut down so hard, I mean, AA's level 7. This is just...
Yeah, the supports are getting their levels just fine. Slardar, unfortunately, he's had a harder time. Just now gets his level 6. You already have a Blink Dagger on S4. Whoa, that, what?
That's just
that
bait.
Certainly wasn't the jump.
That's just bait. Nobody's even TPing.
RP laid down. Mind Control is still going to die here. Gets off the wand. Gets off the stun as well. Just throws down an amp
bottom
damage.
Lane, they're
going
to get Loda to...
Oh, wow.
Nice
Jarek's
combo.
Winter's Curse, Ice Blast combination was enough to get the kill on the Juggernaut.
Yep. Easy one, too. Top lane still. Fada is just around here. I'm wondering if he doesn't go for just a Radiance or something at this point.
Oh, my God. Gyrocopter. He got the Undying, tried to go uphill, runs right into him. I'm going to blame that one on you, Rue.
Not my fault. Not my... I'm just talking about Fada, man. He's got... 2.5k. I mean, this is the perfect time just to go for the Radiance. You're going to be going against a Broodmother. Still adds a little bit of evasion, but...
No, yeah. I'm down with this. I'm absolutely down with this.
Seems like the only person who can really contest the Brood right now.
Yeah, Fada is like actually doing something pretty interesting, trying to get the like neutral creeps with the pull. Trying
bottom,
to just basically
Jarek's
double down his farm. Jarek's getting away. He's going to TP out. He'll be fine. Ake can't see him in time.
That's so annoying how trees just break when you fall to the ground.
He's going a Shadow Blade, and then what? He picks up a gem and just hunts down the Broodmother?
That could be something really good. Huh. He could just create a lot of space for his team. They just really need to have the Slardar just come up here now or soon and just try to find out Bulldog, amplify him. Oh, is this Chemical Rage wearing off? Yes, it is. Bulldog's going to go on him.
Oh, the TP out, though. Fada was prepared for this exact situation.
Yeah, they really needed to have Ake really... Ake has a smoke 2 on him right now. He's level 7. He could have TP'd up there. Maybe could have done something, but... Instead, not going to be using it. That could have been the tier 1 top, so... Maybe a bit of misplay from Alliance showing that Orchid too early.
Another Winter's Curse is ready to go on the Winter Wyvern. Looks like they may want to try and jump the Juggernaut at the bottom lane. Meanwhile, this top lane, it's going to be a pretty quick kill.
Who's
in the
jumping
tower.
Who on the bottom lane is what are you saying?
Yeah, really. S4 has now joined forces. It's going to come forwards. Zinviz. Tier 1 tower about to drop. Fada just now getting here, and Broodmother obviously can't afford to feed away into the Spiderlings. They go, oh, they get mind control. Winter's Curse gets laid out, but it's not enough. There's still enough nuke damage, and Jarek's has thrown down that long cooldown ultimate for nothing. Liquid should now be losing their tier 1 at the bottom lane.
Yeah, and then the Shadow Blade is scouted out in the top lane, so you weren't even going to be able to get a pickoff with it, so unveiling that is not too good. Oh, not spin here. And, well, Kebab, Kuroki, are they going to drop the Tombstone? There we go.
Fada is here with the Shadow Blade. They have an Ice Blast. Looks like Kebab's going to be the target. They should quickly get this kill. Kuro may die to the Brain Sap. Ake gets that one, but a Fiend's Grip, that's going to be stopped. Mind Control gets him. Two-man RP. They've got Loda with the Omni Slash, plus he has the Empower, but it's not going to be enough. Fada just
the
seems
tombstone,
to be tanking
though.
Through it. He has Unstable Concoction ready to go, just waiting up the spin duration. He gets the kill. S4 cleans it up. What was that, a 3-for-3 or something? 2-for-3?
Yeah, it looks like
Liquid lost their Alchemist, though, and Broodmother obviously wasn't a part of that fight, pushing up the top lane the whole entire time.
I would say at the end of the day, yeah, they're getting a better trade from the Alliance side, even though they lost it, but still getting the primary target, getting the Alchemist down, and S4 going to be blinking down, and then just space for Bulldog to do what he always does.
Yeah.
And so it's looking really good. I think it was a little bit of Kebab, kind of like, hey, let's go, guys, let's go, but... Underestimated the AA a little bit there. Mm-hmm. Kind of get burned a little bit, but still a little bit of space made for Alliance elsewhere on the map.
What's Loda going here? Because he still has brown boots. Do you think he's trying to pick up a Boots of Travel?
That's a good question.
And just like with the Broodmother, they could split push really hard?
Earlier we saw a Shadow Blade. So I think Shadow Blade is a really good item on Juggernaut. You can just go hunting. But if you find the Wyvern, it's not really a good kill. But if you find Kuroki, that's just easy food. You don't even have to use your ult team most of the time. So, normally that's what an AA wants to do. You just go into a lane, farm, and that's why we see a lot of times the Bounty Hunter be picked up to counter the AA just because, hey, well, I'm going to be farming alone. I want to farm my Ags in the lane. But did S4 miss? Or no, he just blinked out once he saw the cold or the chilling.
Emerald Bulldog, after taking that tier 1, is now able to get full control of the Dire Jungle and bounce himself even between top and middle if he wants. Botta is going to go hunting here. He does have a Shadow Blade. He's hoping to be able to deter Alliance from pushing in this Tier 1. The rest of Alliance, though, sitting up on this cliff area, ready to intercept or wrap around if Liquid try and rotate.
Damn, man, we'll be getting a free tower in the bottom lane. It will be. Or is he? Oh, they have the setup.
Okay, he's got the Fiend's Grip. Now they have the rest of the TPs in. With S4, they should easily be able to get this kill. The most.
Nice.
Oh, and the deny, too. They get the Ice Blast. RP was used. They were rather scared of that one. Now they may still be intercepted. It looks like Fauna's going to pop his Unstable Concoction. That's a bit early, though. Mind Control's going to find somebody. It's going to be Ake. He'll get that one kill. At least should, anyway. Maybe not. Fauna, you're going to have to run him down for him. He'll get him in the end, but. Okay, doesn't have mana for anything, so Unstable Concoction will get that kill.
Oh, top lane, Jerax is orchided up. Is he going to get chased down? No, he lost to... See, this is where the Phase Boots comes really in handy on the Broodmother. And surprising enough, he didn't get in range for the use of his ulti. So. Jerax.
There's that Boots of Travel for the Juggernaut.
No, bottom lane. Once again, S4 is in trouble. They can throw it.
At the same time,
no.
Kuro's going to be dying to the Omni Slash. S4 trying to get away. Mind Control's ready to go with a stun. He doesn't have a blink up, so it looks like S4's going to be caught by that stun. He has no follow-up, though, unless Mind Control gets... No, he doesn't even have Bash, so there really isn't much opportunity unless he manages to finish him up just now with a stun. Still not enough. Finance finally here gets the Unstable Concoction inside the river with Matu on the other side. They easily clean up the Undying as well, get the Tombstone. Winter Wyvern, he's going to be dying as the Orchid comes in from Admiral Bulldog with all those little spiderlings. They clean up the tower as well and manage to get out. Admiral Bulldog, once again, he's the X factor that's making sure they're winning these fights.
Yeah, definitely. But at the side of things, we are looking at a Roche. And Fada stunning himself to Roche.
Got to scratch your head at that one.
I saw you scratch it too. So.
He really thought he really thought there was somebody here, I guess.
I don't know. But, I guess this is going to be a good trade for Liquid in the end, just because they're going to get the Roche.
You lucky devil. 430 gold off of Bounty Rune in 18 minutes. That's just disgusting.
He only has two integral brood too. He's just playing the like the constant initiator, going around, stopping the brood, and is he gonna find him out? That is the question. Oh, he's gonna find.
He's gonna find something, all right. He needs to actually see Admiral Bulldog. Gets him with the Unstable Concoction.
Oh, he's out of range.
Throws
of
out the dust, but the dust was there. Admiral Bulldog got enough distance. They're gonna get some of those spiderings, but it's only with the Ice Blast, not with Fada's Acid Spray, and the Grievous Greed not gonna benefit.
And that's why sometimes you really wish you had the Blink Dagger instead of the Shadow Blade. But because you could have immediately just jumped right.
They still going to find him, though? Jerax comes in, throws down a counter ward. Uh-oh.
Who's finding who?
Orchid? Oh, Jerax is dead. That Orchid's going to pop him. And Fada has nothing to do now. Stunning himself once again. Mind Control still trying to finish up that Blink Dagger while bottom lane's being pushed out by Mataba Man. Looks like he's, I haven't talked too much about Mataba Man, but he's actually been spending a lot of time kind of pushing out some of these lanes, bottom lane especially, away from the Broodmother.
Yeah, he's been finding farm where he can. He's third on net worth right now, up to 8K. He's got the Aegis ready, so this is definitely Liquid's time to pressure. He just got an Alpha Wolf too. Thanks, guys. That'll help a lot in the next team fight.
He's still really squishy, though. One Omni Slash kills him rather easily.
Yeah, especially with the Empower buff. It's only level 2, because S4 is only level 11 right now. But still, that's why I like seeing these Juggernaut builds. Just go for the mobility as much as you can on Lota. You don't need Battle Fury. You do not need it anymore, especially when you have the Empower. So this is going to be good. He's going for the Sengen Yasha, it looks like. Huh? I mean, it seems like we've seen this picture at least 5 times in the last 10 minutes. Jerax goes to the top lane and almost dies or dies. Oh, look at all that farm.
Yeah, he gets a lot of Splinter Blast targets at least. The Acid Spray will clean up a couple. Yeah, it'll get some of them. There's some profit there for Fada. But Jerax, don't get caught again, my friend. Oh, Ake's seen him, and he's not running to the Haste Rune. We know if he just ran down and got the Haste Rune, he'd be okay. But without that exact escape plan, he was going to be run down by Alliance once again. Still, though, he scouts that out, which means the Mataba Man continues to push out that middle lane. And also, they
Fada.
Know that bottom lane's
they
available. But Fada, he slept up. Boots of Travel's in. They're going to be able to surround him. The Omni Slash gets laid down. Fada is dead. Gyrocopter Ultimate just slowing down some of these heroes, so maybe they can get out. Meanwhile, in the bottom lane, they were actually trying to catch some of these heroes, and maybe if they were just a bit faster, Maybe he had that blink dagger ready to go. They could have stopped. Matumba Man does get slept up. The wolf wakes him up, though. Good little wolfie. Now he's going to turn on to Ake. Matumba Man wants to fight this one out. They know they don't have the Omni Slash with the RP being threatened. S4 winning in the side. They do still have the ample high damage. Mind Control is going to be locked down by that RP in order to save Lota's life. But Mind Control is still hoping to be able to pick up more. S4, he's going to be the target farther up. The Ice Blast landed in Ake. He's not going to take out this time around.
Yep, that was a good RP, though. Saving your carry. Sacrificial Lamb for S4. He was thinking about it. He was like, oh, if I RP, he would have only caught the gyrocopter there. So it was a good no call there from him. But still, Matumba Man up to... Oh, yeah, now he's got a Cardi. We saw last time what happened. I love this play from him, just waking up after that nifty little thing. And
he actually goes the Mantista style. Full-on split pushing. Okay, never mind. He's not sure what he's going for. He sells the Manta recipe because he could afford the full Manta right now if he wants.
Yeah, Manta style is good when you're going against Juggernaut, but not when they have Empower. I don't agree with it.
Yeah, I don't agree either. So yeah, it would have been good for more split pushing, like just throw illusions down a lane. But Fada's coming in. Oh no, Fada. He was spotted out at some point in time. That Ice Blast doesn't come in time to scout out Kabob. They saw him. It's going to pop the dust now, but it's not a fight that Fada can go into without Unstable Concoction.
Yeah, and they still have Force Staff up on S4, so Kabob's still in a perfectly fine position here, kind of baiting out.
Fada's timings on Unstable Concoction have not been great.
It's just the Shadow Blade over the Blink Dagger. Sure, he has a Blink Dagger this time. But
Control gets away with the Blink. Blink on Blink action.
He just got juked that time around.
Well, this is not a good sign for Team Liquid. When you're Alchemist, who very clearly, I mean, we've seen the way that he just gets so much gold from these bounty runes or stacks. He's not top of the net worth board. That should never happen for an Alchemist game. It's just it's Alliance doing a great job controlling him and also farming up well on Admiral Bulldog. He's been quite the star so far.
Yeah, I think Fada might be kicking himself in the butt for not going for that Radiance. I mean, he could have definitely had a lot more net worth in this. Oh, they know what
Invis Rune pops the Shadow Blade now. They can get the quick stun on Lota before he gets off anything. The Ice Blast is not going to be here, but maybe they can still right click him down. He's down to half HP. Winter's Curse laid down with the amp damage. They'll definitely get that kill. Ake being threatened, but with the TP seeing coming in, Liquid just want to back up. Unfortunately, their tier 2 tower is still forfeit.
Surprising he knew he was up there, too, because they had no vision, and all of a sudden he just went into the Shadow Blade.
So is Matu a functioning, like, Broodmother? Every single time, he just seems to be countering the Broodmother's action on the opposite side of the map. Broodmother pushes down a tower, Matumba Man pushes down a tower.
That's what the big bad Matumba Man does. At your door all the time, just like Bulldog. Both of these players have been playing exceptionally well this game so far, and I'm curious to see what Bulldog goes for next. He has 3.2k gold. All right, so he's going to finally finish treads. I still think Phase Boots is really good. It's great because you can synergize. You already have the attack speed bonus coming in from the Orchid, and then just Phase Boots to... I think he could have got one or two extra kills earlier on if he had it. But
gem now for Ake, but both of these teams should be looking at gems rather soon. Liquid haven't gotten theirs, though. But Matumba Man is actually just going to be raw tanking up. He's had a lot of farm. He's been holding on to a lot of gold in the bank for quite some time, but he gets a full-out Reaver, so maybe an early Satanic.
Yeah, definitely a Satanic. It adds a lot of survivability through the RP. Oh, not again, Dota. Not like this. Oh, my. What?
He gets off the queue this time around.
What the?
He's still going to be hit by the Ice Blast, but he may be able to kill Fada with just an Omni Slash. Threatens it. Thinks about it twice. Wants to go for this one, but the rest of the team is here. Stun comes out, but it doesn't actually hit Lota. And Fada now just popped Unstable Concoction for nothing. He hits the stun, kills the healing ward. But they know they need to back up. They've overextended themselves, and that's where S4 is going to be able to hit the catch. But Jerix, he comes in hot with the Winter's Curse, catches S4, and kills him instantly. But the Fiend's Grip onto Fada is actually killing him now. Gyrocopter, though, hits a big-time ultimate, slowing down many of these heroes. But Admiral Bulldog is the turnaround. He gets the BKB Orchid onto Matumba Man, slows down Mind Control instead, realizing this is the better kill, but he can't finish him off. Admiral Bulldog, he has amp damage on him, too. He's slowed down by the Splendid Blast. Matumba Man gets that kill. Jerix is now going to be able to run him down with the Arctic Burn, catching Ake. But he's just going to be run down. The gem has to stay intact, and they do keep it. But ever so barely, as Alliance lose the fight, and it could have been so much worse if Ake had died there.
Yeah, this is very unfortunate. What a great turnaround. That Blink Dagger on Jerix. Easy coming in with the Winter's Curse. And S4 not getting off the RP. kind of sealing the deal there, as well as, you know, the Omni Slash was only used on Kuroki. I mean, he kind of had to use it, else he would have died to the AA. It's very unfortunate Lota got so low to begin with, but yeah. Lota's getting pressured in the middle lane, but he can't really do anything about it. And
great timing on the Blink Dagger from Jerix. He went for that pretty much first item, Arcane Boots. He went for a Sage's Mask, but I think maybe Glimmer Cape would be the other item that you would discuss on a Winter Wyvern. But clearly, you saw the way that Winter Wyvern Blink Dagger was an exceptional counter to S4's Magnus. Every single time you're going to RP in, especially with some of these melee heroes, you're going to be grouped up. You think you have the advantage, but there's going to be that counterplay every single time.
Yeah, they do have the counterplay with the Bane, but he was just a little bit too far away. Sure, he casted the Fiend's Grip, but he really needed to cast the Nightmare as well onto the Slardar, but he didn't have enough time. And then once Matumbo Man came in, it was just all over from there. And, well, Fada, what is he going for now? He's going for the Assault. That's going to help out his team a lot. How close is he to it?
More armor upgrades are going to mean a lot against this Juggernaut. It seems they're really focused on just surviving through the Omni Slash play. Between Gyrocopter tanking up, Fada, obviously his build is a little bit more gank heavy, but the AC is going to help out.
Oh, here we
everyone.
Go.
They're going to find their initiation. Oh, S4 with a quick blink retreat. Now Lota's here, and he's going to be able to catch Matumbo Man, but Matumbo Man's tanking is all hell. He's going to be able to get to about half HP before Lota's forced to return mind control. He's been caught by the Fiend's Grip, and he will die. And here comes that Ice Blast on the side. Emerald Bulldog's going to be controlled up during that BKB. Matumbo Man choosing to fight against this, but he can't really run away. He doesn't have enough damage, and the rest of the team is on full retreat. The Unstable Concoction comes in and hits Emerald Bulldog, but they've lost their gem. And Liquid may lose even more. The TP out from Kuroki.
Critted!
Oh, the crit comes out from Lota. This time around, the 2-for-3s in the favor of Alliance.
You know, when you have a big, bad spider running at you, you normally want to squash it, but Admiral Bulldog is not getting squashed. He's been so superb. I'm glad to see him back in form here, and he's just doing so much work for his team right now.
The plate mail pickup, I think, was huge there. That actually mitigated so much of the damage coming out from the Gyrocopter.
As well
and
as
Gyrocopter
the
already doesn't have a whole lot of damage with this Satanic build.
And the incapacitating bite. Don't forget when the BKB ran out. Or no, he doesn't even have a BKB. So I'm kind of confused. No BKB on Gyrocopter for the incapacitating bite. Freaking hard word to say, and as well as the there's no MKB coming out.
Several times now, this time around, the Satanic showed some of its worth in that Gyrocopter didn't just instantly die to Omni Slash. But there's supposed to be the Winter Wyvern there, and always to get the Cold Embrace off. It seemed like the MKB, the damage build, would have been better on Gyrocopter in this case, both in a previous fight where Gyrocopter wasn't targeted and was the kind of last one in, and also in this case where, yeah, he managed to survive, but most of the time there should be that Cold Embrace counterplay.
He's always the last one that should be going into the team fight, sort of. So it's kind of like, all right, well, we got the Alk going in, Slardar, everybody, and then here you go. Here's the Gyro. Clean it up. And so, yeah, going this really defensive build, it's not something I would, per se, is great, but still, if he could have survived a little bit longer, maybe helped out, but
he really seems to think sticking to survivability is his best play because he's not going MKB, he's going Butterfly next. Or maybe he's just getting the Talisman, as that does hold a lot of value.
Yeah. So we did see Lota go for the Manta style now, and he disassembled it for the Sage, but Lota definitely needs an MKB as in his next item. MKB prioritized just for the Alchemist, for the Gyrocopter, and still he does get hard countered by this Winter Wyvern Cold Embrace. So they really need to get a big RP, but they're not letting S4 have these opportunities.
Haha, Kuro. He already wanted to spot that one out. He thought there might have been a ward before, and this time he does see Kebab trying to place down that cliff ward. They're keeping vision inside the Roshan pit. Both teams are. Admiral Bulldog with his spider, Ice Vortex from Kuro. Alliance, the stalemate. They're going to force something out of it. They're going to go for the tier 1 tower at the very least.
Double damage!
I mean, with Lotus' fast, godlike reactions.
Oh, Fada jumps forward. He's going to get the Unstable Concoction, but once again, S4 is able to dodge that one. Fada really thought that maybe there was that time with perhaps a two-man Unstable Concoction, catching S4 with a DD on him. It might have been the great opportunity for a fight, especially since Mind Control could have followed that up. But S4, once again, I mean, both Lota and S4 are showing superb reaction time that has been part of the reason that Liquid haven't gotten the initiation they wanted.
took the words right out of my mouth. It's like you're in my head.
That's what good co-casters do, buddy.
Okay.
Liquid, do the five-man smoke. See if they can find somebody.
And they probably will find Admiral Bulldog.
I mean, Admiral Bulldog's in the trees, though. It's always difficult to catch him. He's got the AC complete.
That means no buyback, though.
Smokes haven't popped just yet. They're going to go back into the Roshan pit. No, they know there's a spider there. They know there's never a chance to sneak Roshan. So it seems just kind of like pointless what they're doing right now. No real clear directive.
And Oda once again on the front lines. Bulldog is not here. If they had started that team fight, then Liquid could have maybe gone out on top. But still, you still have the S4 with his Force Dev. And now you have Bane. This is looking really good for Alliance.
Halberd for the Juggernaut.
What?
He actually uses that stage to get some evasion of his own and a disarm against a team that doesn't have BKBs. This could actually be super valuable in this next fight. Alliance know it too. Fada sitting in there with a Shadow Blade. He's already got his Chemical Rage out, but he's going to stun himself. This is really bad for Liquid.
They have the gem on S4. Do they have vision on?
They can't afford to just lose this fight due to the fact that they don't have Chemical Rage anymore. So Liquid probably need to stall time now.
Matumba Man in the front.
Oh, Matumba Man, don't get initiated like that. Oh, that's going to be three ultimates. They do have a response, though, but Winter Wyvern's already dead. Three man stun, Ice Blast, Unstable Kakashi. Never mind, Alliance. They stumbled into a trap of their own. Beautiful setup there from the Winter Wyvern response. And now they're going to try and catch even more. Admiral Bulldog, he's been spotted as he tried to go for the Ancient Apparition. And that is going to be a fourth down now.
It's just the crush. Oh, my God. The crush into Alchemist. This is, it's just, they have too many cores, it feels like, on the side of Liquid here. If it's not Matumba Man, it's Fada. And then you also have Mind Control just coming in, easy cleanup. That Kuroki AA blast over the top. Superb play coming in from them. Sure, you kill one of our heroes, but oh man. In the end of the
Alliance,
game.
They really got to be a bit more careful with their positioning in this sort of group up. S4 bought back from that one, too. I really think that the attempted skewer play was unnecessary. Right? It seemed like Matumba Man was fairly well caught in a bad position just through the Fiend script. Him grouping everybody together via the skewer was not ideal.
Yep. It's just very hard to play when you're this hero, you're Magnus. You have to have, that's your only initiation basically in this game. You kind of want to use your skewer just to get somebody out of position, then force staff in and then hit that big RP. But S4 really hasn't had the opportunity to seize. Now looking at this, Matumba Man is going to have this butterfly completed. This tier 2 tower is going to go down, and with the Aegis still having a long time, I would say that Liquid have a really good chance just to go the high ground if they really want to. I don't see how they're going to kill Gyrocopter as well as
double
this.
Damage.
I mean, they can't even kill the Alchemist either. So they just need to itemize better. I mean, Lota doesn't have anything. Sure, he has all these utility items, but doesn't really have the DPS right now. It's only sitting at 200.
Five-man smoke wrap around. Jerix is here. Do they realize where he's at? Yeah, S4 does. He gets the skewer back with the Winter's Curse laid down. Now the follow up. They get the Ice Blast over the top on it too. That should be S4 going down. Admiral Bulldog's going to try and battle it out with his BKB on the front lines going on Fada, but it's not enough. Now the Omni Slash, it just doesn't seem to do much damage. Even Kuro survives through it. And Matumba Man still has an extra life. They're going to try and surround Lota here. Kuro doesn't want to get too close though. And Fada, well, he got slept up, so no real pursuit there. Blinks up, but Lota's going to go for the TP out. We'll be fine. Liquid, realizing there's no need to go on that Juggernaut anymore. Looks like they're just going to continue to push out now.
They're just, it looking like they're just way too far behind. This Winter Wyvern, they really need to get the Orchid off onto him first. Like, I would really love to see if Bulldog should have went for like a Blink Dagger Orchid onto the Wyvern. Like, this is just too much control right now happening in.
Matumba Man heals himself back up to full via the Satanic, knowing that he's still got that second life, and Satanic will be off cooldown when it's needed. Unstable Concoction, just buying more time before Lota can actually come forward with his illusions. Looks like the Melee Rax is going to go down here.
Disarm
buys a little bit more time. Ice Blast coming in. This could actually be a pretty decent position for Alliance to fight soon. Ok almost dying just to that flat cannon shot. Melee Rax does go down. Liquid, knowing that many of their ultimates are on cooldown. Time to back up. Chemical Rage and Ice Blast still need some time.
Yep. Didn't have all their heroes there. Roki's still in the fountain, which you're kind of fine with throwing these AA Blasts all over the map. He doesn't necessarily need to be there. Curse probably just came back up, and with Gyro having no mana, it's really hard to just keep continuing. It's kind of like a last-ditch effort Alliance need to just pull right now.
This is an Abyssal for Fada, correct? Or is he looking to really stop the S4 Blink with Radiance?
No, if he was Radiance, he would have probably bought it already. I guess you could say buyback, but at this stage in the game, they're just so far ahead. You kind of don't need to worry about the buybacks. As long as Matumba Man has it, one of your cores. But he doesn't have it. He's all in, too. But I would be, too, at this scenario. It's not looking pretty for Alliance.
He's got the Aegis. He's feeling pretty confident about it. They're going to come in from behind. Looks like they want to try and stop Jarex first. They do get the nice Nightmare and Skewer Bank that puts Matumba Man into a bad position. The supports are still being gone on by Admiral Bulldog, and the cores do need to try and respond. Stun. Looks like Admiral Bulldog managed to dodge that one ever so barely and sitting in the trees, waiting out his time. Tier 3 tower does go down. Supports continue to be threatened by those spiders. They got his guy. Eventually, Admiral Bulldog now popping his head out there. Ice Blast gets laid in. Oh, Matumba Man's right in the middle of this fight. Managed to slow down 3. We'll be able to get 2 pickups. Now the Winter's Curse on Alota ensures that this is going to be the end of the fight. Admiral Bulldog hopes to be able to get Jarex at the very minimum, but he can't even get that much. The Orchid will get the kill after his death. But post-mortem is not the words that Alliance were looking for here.
EG.
As they lose game number 3, Liquid will be moving on in the upper bracket against OG.
I mean, that looked like a little bit of a miscommunication there from Alliance there at the end, because I thought Ake was going to Fiend's Grip Matumba Man, and then they were going to go in with the RP on maybe 1 or 2, and it didn't happen, and this Gyrocopter got 4-man flat cannon, but the game was kind of over at that point in the game, though.
Yeah, it seemed like they were trying to make some sort of play, Admiral Bulldog stopping the Winter Wyvern while they go in, but it's just Liquid were able to kind of persevere through that 25-minute marker. That was, I think, their biggest hump they had to get through.
Yeah, actually, looking at that game, I mean, right when Alliance picked up that Broodmother, everyone was like, oh, right. However, at the beginning, it did seem to work out for them pretty well. Actually, behind the scenes, we heard Blitz saying, like, well, it's a Broodmother. What are you expecting? Broodmother always works. That was, I think, that's the meme.
Yeah, he was like, mocking us greatly.
Yeah.
Forever doubting the Admiral Bulldog Broodmother or any Broodmother.
I mean, it still doesn't change the fact that Broodmother had a lot of counters there, and Broodmother would have been a stronger hero if it wasn't for the fact that there are like 4 different heroes to be able to deal with it in some fashion or the other.
Yeah.
I mean, Broodmother's still a Broodmother, it's still gonna be a problem. Like, but ultimately at the end of the day, Team Liquid had, I think, just the better draft all around.
Early scrappy fights were good for Alliance just because of how the draft really worked out, you know, sort of single target, we'll pick off one, another. But as we started to see the game progress, you could definitely tell that there were multiple combos there for Liquid. You know, you had the Curse, AA Blast, then you had the combination of the Alchemist jumping onto any one of those two as well. Even the two supports combined up together like 10 minutes in to kill the Jug. Just the Wyvern AA went to that bottom tier 1, took out the Juggernaut alone. And that just shows how strong that multiple heroes could be on Liquid, whereas Alliance had to go 3-4, and S4's Magnus really kind of fell off as the game went on.
But, like prior to the game, when we were in the Pigs and Bands, we did talk about the Alchemist, and you all said, like, oh, well, that's going to be a big problem. However, Feta didn't seem to do that well on it, actually.
Yeah, he ended up getting it with the Blink Dagger as well as the Shadow Blade, and then stunned himself more than he was stunning the enemy. and it was like, you can understand why he did it, because the Slaughter took so long to come online with his own initiation, or he felt like that was going to happen, so he kind of filled the role for that. But the moments never really appeared, and then Alliance kind of gave them a couple of moments as well.
I think the same kind of joke can be kind of said, right? The same about the Broodmother as it is about the Alchemist. It's an Alchemist. Like, what do you expect? That hero's always going to get some essence of farm.
He had 1 CS 3-4 minutes in, but was still like level 3.5 to 4. And it was like,
had second net worth too.
Yeah.
Second net worth with 3 CS. Alchemist things.
It was the old rule for the Alchemist. Like, you got 1 CS. If you're taking 2 bounty runes, you win the lane. So I was sitting there when Kebab died, taking the first bounty rune. I'm like, wait, is this actually worth it? This could actually be worth it to deny up the Alchemist.
Yeah, I think denying the runes early on, I was really surprised by Bulldog not putting a web down there and maybe contesting it, because we've seen if you just leave the Alchemist do whatever he wants. Sure, he didn't have the perfect game that game on Fada, as we saw throughout the one. He stunned himself constantly. But still, the presence there, he still got up the AC, got all these solar crests, all these supporting items, and it wasn't, it was still on them to really mess up the team fights just because they were so far ahead. S4 is the biggest thing to me, as Durka said during that game, where he just fell off completely. They countered him because the last two games, it was Bulldog initiating the team fights. Now it's S4 having to initiate these team fights, but you're initiating into a Wyvern, and it's kind of on like Bulldog. Okay, so you have to kind of Orchid the Wyvern and find him and trying to isolate him while S4 can get a good RP. But it was just more on, you know, well, we just got Wyverned, and he couldn't do anything in the team fight.
Two positional supports from Liquid sitting at the back. Like I said, Bulldog has to come from the side, and Alliance had one combo, really, right? It's the RP into Empowered, Juggernaut, physical damage. Once the Alchemist had AC, there was nothing to nuke him down. There was nothing to actually finish off him or the Gyro when he had that Satanic. It was just so difficult to get these pickoffs.
Kind of comes back to what you said during the draft. Where was the Lina? Maybe that's what you had to go for.
I think it's something actually you said as well during the cast, that they're just lacking the damage.
Yeah, I was about to go back to that point where Lota had these really weird items where he needed to go into probably not the Boots of Travel, kind of the drums, into maybe a Shadow Blade or into the Saint Jinyasha first, and then get probably an MKB to deal with the Solar Crest and eventually the Butterfly coming out from the Gyrocopter. So we're going to be looking at this team fight here.
Oh, Alliance doesn't want to watch this one again.
Yeah, Alliance had kind of a good initiation here. We thought it was going to look amazing for them, but all of a sudden we saw the crush come in later.
Yeah, it was just like they had this Fiend's Grip and then S4 choosing to skewer back. It makes sense in some ways, but it also just set Jerix up. Like, look at these heroes. They're grouped up as three. Then there's going to be the AoE response from all these
heroes.
Look at
that Satanic heal. Oh, that's ouch. Nasty. The biggest thing, too, is Lota got his ulti off. He did it right, but it bounced to the Wyvern, and you basically lose the whole team fight just because of that one bounce. Very unfortunate, too, because that is all their DPS. It's all on Lota. Of course, Bulldog did contribute a lot, but it's an Orchid, BKB. He's kind of like, I'm kind of standing on the front line. Stir, unstable, and insatiable hunger. It's pretty good, but, I mean, at the end of the day, it kind of was all on Lota to really carry that game, and I just think his item choices kind of hindered the team a little bit.
Where has this build come from? The Brown Boots, Drums, Aquila into BOTs? Because that was like the PL build, right? We used to see that a hell of a lot, where you want to kind of split push and move around the map. We didn't see Lota do much split pushing. He was actually building this and then joining fights.
He joined like one fight I can remember, maybe
the pickoff on the Alchemist where they were bottom lane.
I remember that, but
and then he TP'd up to top with the Broodmother.
And I don't remember much, like you're saying. The Boots of Travel just seemed very useless because they weren't able to get off these pickoffs, and they weren't able to really split up the map as effectively as they maybe wanted to.
But I can tell you some guys who are happy about the outcome of this game, which is going to be alternate. I have been talking to some of those guys before this match started, and they did say that they would rather face off against Alliance in the lower bracket now. They have been playing against Team Liquid very recently. They actually said it didn't go too bad. I mean, it was a 2-1, I think, in Team Liquid's favor, but they felt like the games have actually been fairly close. However, they still said that they would prefer to actually go up against Alliance, so they do get their wish. We are playing in a double elimination bracket here, so yeah, we will be seeing Alliance playing again tomorrow, as well as, of course, Team Alternate. But for now, we will head over to the upper bracket final, which will be OG going up against Team Liquid, which is probably some people would maybe also consider to be happening in the finals itself.
Yeah. I mean, if I had to predict the bracket, if I had to predict the graphic, I would definitely have Team Liquid facing against OG. I think they're the two strongest teams here.
We all just nod and smile, yeah.
All right, no, that's okay. I made a statement. You all agree. Why would you say that? So that's okay.
The only big question will be what would happen in the lower bracket if Alliance as well as Liquid do match up again, as if OG go into the finals.
I hope the same as now. I hope for some really close clutch games. Yep. So, but we will see if that's going to happen or not. We will be heading into a break first, and then we are back with the upper bracket final. OG going up against the guys from Team Liquid, so stay tuned.